Hello, everyone. Welcome back to Seeker Plus. I'm your host, Julian Huguet, and as you may know, I'm someone who has a lot of different interests. And as a result, there are a lot of things I need to get done at any given time. Frankly, I never have enough. Most weeks, I'm juggling multiple projects, each with their own demands and deadlines. And something else about me, I'm always trying to learn new things. Sometimes I'm deep into research on a topic for something like this podcast, or because, you know, it's 3 a.m. and I have Wikipedia open. Sometimes I'm working on learning a new instrument, or I'm building something. And I know I'm not alone in this, whether you're studying for school or learning a new language or just trying to be more productive with all the work you have to do, learning is a constant. And personally, I'd love to be better at it. I'd like to learn, as they say. So I thought I'd talk about the science of how we learn things. I'll do some myth busting about the whole visual versus auditory or sensory learner thing. I'll explore proven methods for learning new skills faster or remembering information for longer periods of time, and ultimately go into how we could all be structuring our time to be more productive and as efficient as humanly possible. Oh, and on that note, we'll get into toxic productivity too. That's important. There's a lot to cover here, so let's take it from the top. In short, learning is how we create a mental model of the world around us. For animals, learning occurs when a personal experience results in behavioral change. So something happens to them, and then they act differently as a result. Not all organisms do this. Some insects, for example, spend their lives following a set of developmental steps without ever reacting differently to the world around them. They may never change their behavior based on something they perceive. They have little need to learn. In a human example, if you were to touch a hot stove, you'd immediately pull your hand away without much thought, right? Pulling your hand away, though, isn't a learned behavior. It's a reaction. But if in the future you avoid touching the stove in the first place, that would be learning. You're changing your behavior based on a past experience. Learned behaviors are developed over time by organisms that need to react to a world that's unstable and unpredictable. Learning where predators live and avoiding that area can mean the difference between survival and being lunch. When we're born, a lot of our learning comes easily. Our young brains are pre-wired to learn what's known as biologically primary material. This material includes things like your first language. It's how a toddler learns to talk, even without having to run flashcards like I do, or pull an all-nighter. Later in life, our brains have to work harder to learn biologically secondary material. This would be things like math, writing, playing an instrument, or speaking a new language as an adult. Hajimemashite. The process of acquiring that secondary material is understood to happen in three steps: encoding, storage, and retrieval. It doesn't really matter what you're learning. It could be the map layout of Metroid Dread, or training to become a surgeon. You still encode, store, and retrieve. And understanding how these steps work is how we can approach learning more effectively. So, encoding, it's how information is taken into your brain in the first place. Now, there are a lot of different ways that we absorb the world around us. I won't go into all of the clinical definitions, but we can encode by responding to different stimuli around us, by problem solving, by repetition, by association, and more. All of these are just categories of those individual experiences I mentioned earlier that teach us to behave differently. We'll come back to the steps of storage and memory retrieval later, but right now I want to focus on encoding and get into how we actually take in information, both in a classroom and out. Now, I don't know about you, but when I was growing up, I was told that people are either visual or auditory learners, that you learn best either by looking at a picture or by listening to a teacher. But lately, well, frankly, science has been tearing that idea apart. The idea of different learning styles for students has been around for a while, but really it exploded in the 90s when a teacher named Neil Fleming created something known as the VARC questionnaire. He felt that if people had strong and unique preferences for things like cars, food, partners, maybe they have preferences for the ways that they learn too. To answer his question, Fleming observed more than 9,000 different classes, which is a lot of extra school for an adult to sit through. And that's before you could record classes and watch a lecture at double speed, and my attention span, I just couldn't, I'm sorry. From his observations, Fleming made a list of questions to help students figure out what kind of learners they are. It's called VARC. V for visual, A for oral, R for read or write, and K for kinesthetic. So, it was meant to determine whether you learn better by seeing diagrams, by hearing information, by reading or writing, or by practicing it hands-on. And the questions include things like, if you have a problem with your heart, would you prefer that the doctor A, showed you a diagram of what was wrong, B, described what was wrong, C, gave you something to read to explain what was wrong, or D, used a plastic model to show you what was wrong? And this perspective on learning made sense for a lot of educators. If you could tailor your teaching method to a student's particular learning style, wouldn't they learn better? Here's where science comes in and asks for receipts. In a 2018 study out of Indiana University, hundreds of students took the VARC questionnaire to see if their results lined up with the ways they naturally like to study. If not, then they were given study strategies that fit their VARC learning style. The study found that the students who did these new strategies didn't actually do better on their tests. The researchers also found that even though they were involved in this study, many students completely ignored the techniques recommended to them based on their learning styles, which is like the most college thing to happen in your carefully planned research study. But still, this is evidence that learning styles don't give students an advantage. By the way, that paper is titled Another Nail in the Coffin for Learning Styles, so the researchers really aren't putting up with any misinterpretations of their data. Study after study has reached the same conclusion. There's no correlation between sticking to your supposed learning style and actually performing better. As another sassy article title put it, learning styles, where's the evidence? Even Neil Fleming has backed off a bit, saying in an article of his own in 2006 that sometimes students and teachers invest more belief in VARC than it warrants, and that some also confuse preference with ability or strengths. You can like something, but whether or not you're good at it, that's another matter. Like me and hockey. And relationships. One study found that learning using multiple styles can be helpful, though. So engaging with information with words and visuals may be better than using just words alone. It's a good reason to lean into multimedia learning. Seeker videos. Oh, excuse me. All this is not to say that people learn in the same way. There are people who think in fundamentally unique ways. For example, people with autism or dyslexia, or, like me, with ADHD. And that can have a big impact on how they learn. But regardless of how best you encode information, all of this begs the question, what actually is the best way to learn? Which brings me to those next steps involved in learning, storage and retrieval. This is how the brain takes the information it's absorbed and can not only hold on to it, but pull it out and use it when the situation requires it. So, let's get into what neuroscience has to say about optimizing learning and building long-term memories that serve us when we really need them. I'm talking about neuroplasticity, working memory, synapses, and how to tap into the 90% of your brain that we don't use. Just kidding, that last one's not real. It's the hook of that well-known Bradley Cooper movie. You know the one I'm talking about. We'll get into all of that and more in the next episode for Seeker Plus. Thanks for tuning in, and hey, let us know if you like what we're doing here and what topics you want us to cover in the future. We can talk about really everything. For you, if you want to, we could talk about pills that supposedly give you access to 100% of your brain if you want. The episode would probably be mostly me rolling my eyes and shaking my head, but we could do it. Just let us know. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you on the next episode.